now have broken out in several cities in Kazakhstan. Thousands of people clashing with police, storming government buildings, protesting the rising gas prices, which virtually doubled overnight. Now, Kazakhstan's president has declared a state of emergency in parts of the country, saying that he would address the legitimate demands, but warning his government will not fall. Senior foreign correspondent Ian Padel is monitoring the situation from London. He joins us now live for more. You know, Ian, this is a rare sight for Kazakhstan. What do you think is going to happen here with these protests and how folks are reacting and how the government is responding? It's just not normal for this area.
Yeah, you're right, Kira. I mean, we forget that after the fall of the Berlin Wall, all countries turned to Western-style democracy. Many of them have been governed by so-called strongmen, authoritarian leaders. Kazakhstan is certainly one of them. The situation there on the ground, as you say, is developing rapidly. We've seen these mass protests gripping cities across this huge former Soviet country. And Kazakhstan is about the size of Western Europe. The demonstrations, as you say, sparked by this sudden rise in gas prices. Then they spread across the country, even though the government has made a whole bunch of concessions. The government there is a major energy producer, but as I say, it's been dominated by this authoritarian father of the nation, he's been likes to be referred to, the Sultan Nazarbayev, his former Communist Party boss, the key ally of Russia's Vladimir Putin. Many other authoritarian leaders across the region are going to be looking at what's going on. No one more closely than Vladimir Putin and the Kremlin, who of course are nervous about the signs of any kind of popular uprising on their doorstep. We saw their reaction with Belarus. Today, they're saying they're watching the situation closely and urging other nations not to interfere. Kira.
And knowing of the people in Kazakhstan, Ian, and what's happening here, and just the background of this president, he's made it very clear his government's not going to fall. Then he's got this relationship with Vladimir Putin. Put into perspective, you know, the options here of where this could go.
I mean, I think if you like, really, Belarus is the test case. There are two clear directions. Either the protesters gather momentum, and some people are saying online, well, look, this is starting to look like a revolution. I don't think it's there yet. But we've seen unverified video from different towns and cities across Kazakhstan of the police stepping to one side, of the protesters taking over government buildings. Perhaps it gathers momentum. We're now seeing that the Sultan Nazarbayev, who has this, he's a former president, has this position of so-called father of the nation. He's no longer going to be head of the National Security Council. But the current sitting president is saying, basically, I'm not going to go anywhere. And if this protest continued, then he is going to act. Now, that is what we saw from Alexander Lukashenko in Belarus, that the protests gather momentum up to a certain point, and then the regime essentially clamped down with brutality, with mass arrest, with people being killed in custody. And that is the fear that the government then resorts to force to try and enforce its rule. And let's not forget, no authoritarian leader likes to go quietly. This isn't going to be an easy process. And with Russia on one side, China on the other, and a whole bunch of other countries that are ruled by authoritarian leaders around Central Asia, I think everyone is going to be watching this very nervously and wanting to know which direction this goes. It matters because Kazakhstan is a very important country, not just because of its oil wealth, because of its size, its population. It's an important country in the region. It also matters because of the signal that it sends to other countries in the region.
Ian Ban, I'll always appreciate your insight. Thank you so much for joining us this morning.
Hi, everyone. George Stephanopoulos here.